Hi, so I can start, right? Okay. Hi, this is Jae Suk An and Jun Han from SK Telecom. So today we'll talk about our experience using Airship project for the production environment. So this is case study talk, so it will have both non-technical and technical aspect of Airship. So SKT has been participating in OpenStack Camp project and Airship project from the beginning, but had different use cases and different requirements than AT&T. So we did a bit of different way from what AT&T did. So actually, because of those differences, we leveraged some of the Airship technology and actually built a open source software of our own called Taco. I'll explain that in the presentation. I also briefly explain what Airship is and its current status and relationship with SKT. Then we'll talk about why SKT used Airship and what was our requirements and what it did and what we are going to do with Airship. Especially, we'll talk deeply on the most important production case we did, NFV production for our LTE and 5G NSA using Airship-based technology. And I hope this presentation will help someone who wants to adopt Airship into their system. So let's talk about the brief introduction on Airship project. So anyone heard of Airship and look at Airship project? Okay. So here is Airship's mission statement. Airship provides a collection of loosely coupled tools in order to declaratively automate infrastructure lifecycle management. It does have several sub-projects under its umbrella, and from document and manifest management and bare metal provisioning and Kubernetes installations and Helm chart orchestration. Even in Airship 1.0, all the things happen with container-centric automation tools. And Airship has unique values than other lifecycle management automations. First is declarative. It provides a document, declarative document. So if you throw this document into Airship's system, then Airship will take care of everything else. It's declarative way. And also, Airship uses containers as a core unit of the software delivery, from bare metal provisioning to the OpenStack deployment. This is all based on the container-based technology. And also, Airship provides one unified workflow for all the lifecycle management. So you're doing the patch set update, upgrade, or node scale out. That's done by just one simple workflow. And it's also very flexible. Airship has been pilot project, but just became the confirmed project in this summit. So now it's one of the component projects on the OpenStack Foundations. So here's history of Airship. Airship, before the Airship, there is a project called OpenStack Helm project, which is making Helm chart for all the OpenStack component. And SKT initially involved in this Helm project from the development. And then the Airship was initiated in 2017. And AT&T, Intel, and SKT actually initiated this project. And at that time, SKT was involved in one of sub-projects called Armada, Airship Armada. Then Airship becomes OpenStack Foundation pilot project in 2018. And SKT was still leveraging Airship Armada and OpenStack Helm, but we built our own open source software in late 2017, leveraging Airships. And also, SKT continued to participate in user of Airship Armada project. And right now, SKT will fully align with Airship 2.0 development. So SKT is actively working with Airship community to develop version 2.0. Which will come next year. And 2.0 will fully align with Kubernetes and CNCF technologies. So this is why we did not use the entire Airship stack, why we used some of airships, not all. So at the time, we looked into airship, we had some of the requirements and differences. The first, we already had Kubernetes deployment tools. We used KubeSpray and KubeADM. Airship provide their own tools to provision Kubernetes, but that's the Airship's custom-built tool. So we went for the community-centric tools. And also, our operation team had the bare metal provisioning tools. So we have to integrate with their bare metal provisioning. And also, SKT already had SAP capability with SAP Ansible deployment tool. We had very well capable storage expert and tools we are using. And also, operation team had its own operation tools and had no plan to upgrade for the Airship technology. So we have to make choice. But the Airship 1.0, this is very good chain of tools, but it was very difficult to, if you want to integrate your own tool into this pipeline, that was almost impossible for the Airship 1.0. So we had to integrate with our existing tools and conditions. So we had to adopt not entire stuff, but just what we need. That was Airship Armada, which is orchestrate Helm chart. So I'll explain a little bit more detail on that later. And in this section, I'll explain why SKT has been involved in Airship and other related projects like OpenStack Helm. So everyone knows, with LTE, network virtualization started, and virtualizing network functions to run LTE pipeline. SKT also did NFV VNF on our LTE pipeline. With LTE pipeline virtualized, OpenStack became a reference standard technology for its virtualized infrastructure management tools. So it's an edge architecture, and since OpenStack was a reference tool. From that point on, OpenStack became one of the most critical and important platform in telco environment. And telco use case was not having like a large scale public cloud. That's not telco use case. But we had to have multiple small, medium OpenStack clusters to run our LTE pipelines. And to run these multiple OpenStack clusters and operability was very important. So easy to patch, easy to upgrade, easy to update, and easy to scale, easy to deploy. That was the most wanted feature for the telco OpenStack. But we didn't see that from any vendor. So we decided to find our own way to improve how we can improve those operability of OpenStack. That's why we looked into OpenStack on Kubernetes architecture in 2016, and it connected us to the Airship project. Then 5G happens, and NFV is continuously evolving from VNF to the hybrid, meaning that it just started to have a CNF called containerized network functions, and the Kubernetes to run the CNF. Soon, telco network infrastructure will become the hybrid environment where VMs and containers are located in our environment. And that made us clear that we really need to embrace this cloud-native infrastructure concept into our system to run our 5G network infrastructures. And that also made us to look into more in Airship, because Airship provides some of the cloud-native way of running your infrastructures. Then further, with 5G, cloud moves to the edge from the public internet place. So edge that is located within telco's network pipeline. And pipeline itself also becoming cloud-native architectures. And telco now needs to become not telco operator, but cloud operators to host various ultra-low latency services in our own edge cloud. In addition, various technical business integration with public cloud vendors are also happening on our network edge cloud. And all of these new requirements and environments make us to focus more on the cloud-native infrastructure technologies. And here are the reference MEC architecture being built with cloud-native concepts in SKT. And it's clear that we need flexible cloud infrastructure capability. And we think Airship can bring the right set of technologies and healthy community ecosystem to achieve our goal to innovate our infrastructure for the 5G. Another important domain for us, for SKT, and the broadcasting and media, especially like connected with 5G network capability. The ATS 3.0, known as Next Gen TV, is like a new set of standard platform for the broadcasting domain. So it brings data connectivity into traditional over-the-air broadcast signal. So with 1.0, you only need broadcasting. But with 3.0, you can put data onto your broadcasting signal. And that creates new business opportunity for the company, like a broadcasting company and media company. With new system in town, there has been active discussion on how we can virtualize this broadcasting pipeline. And also, NBMP, stands for Network-Based Media Processing, is MPEG's version of media-centric edge computing spec. So MPEG is right now making a spec for this platform and interfaces. As I described here in this slide, virtualization or cloudification of media functions and edge computing capability for the media is rapidly coming into broadcasting and media industry. And here's ATS 3.0 architecture. It requires cloud-based infrastructure to run this pipeline. And here is logical service diagram combining 5G and edge computing and network-based media processing capability altogether. And it brings this new generation of media services not only for the telco infrastructure, but also for the media pipelines. So SKT recently founded a joint venture with Sinclair, which is USA broadcasting company, to develop and apply Airship-based cloud technology for their new ATS 3.0 platform and MBMP implementations. So this is another important goal for SKT, embracing Airship 2.0. So now let's talk about what SKT has been doing with Airships. So as I said, we integrate Airship Armada, not entire Airship, and OpenStack Helm, and SAP, of course, Kubernetes, and other projects into our own project called Taco. And since it's based on the Airship, it's also container-based and has declarative measurement and very predictable and resilient. And it's also open source. This is basic architecture. So we leverage this, the Cola to make OpenStack containers and OpenStack Helm to develop a chart to packaging and deploy these OpenStack containers and using Airship Armada to orchestrate multiple charts all together. So you don't need to go to the individual chart to do the like a value upgrade and apply. You only need a single manifest to orchestrate all the chart you need to install on the system. That's Armada. And also we use KubeSpray, which is Ansible-based community project to deploy Kubernetes. But we use KubeSpray with KubeADM capability. And also for the monitoring, we're using Prometheus and EFK. Elasticsearch and Flaunt Bit and Kibana. So that's like a basic set of technology we are using. And with Taco, we actually deployed several production infrastructure. The first, targeting this month, November, we are deploying NFV for the LTE 5G NSA. And also we built our private cloud for the developers and testbed in early 2019. And also the cloud PC, virtual desktop interface services using our infra from this Airship-based technology. And also one of the good thing using the Airship and OpenStack Helm, it provides Kubernetes capability. So we are able to put some of the containerized big data platforms on top of it as well as OpenStack. Also, we are providing our solution to the media cloud. So So we already did several use cases, production use cases, using this technology. And also, we also built a strong CI/CD pipeline to ensure that the continuous stability environment with rapidly changing upstream code base and various different use cases and changing requirements, our own code development, it's all merged into this CI/CD pipeline. Also, we build those pipelines on top of Kubernetes so that we can continuously release our stable version, adapting all the changes. And this is our the continuous development tool called TacoPlay. As I said, we're using the Airship Armada and OpenStack Ham, but for the other thing, mainly we are using Ansible. So we wrap everything with Ansible. We're using Ironic, standalone Ironic, but also with Ansible wrapper. And also we are using Step Ansible. And also we are doing OS configuration with Ansible. And we are installing Dockers and registry and necessary software using Ansible. And also we built a Ansible wrapper for the Armada and OpenStack Ham. So operator can just use one simple interface, Ansible playbook, to deploy everything. So it becomes just one Ansible command line to install from the bare metal to the OpenStack using Airship and Kubernetes technology. So that's our current version. And also it's on the GitHub as open source. We opened lately in July 2019. And unfortunately, documentation is only written in Korean because we don't have any research to translate into English, but the code is there. So, but this current version, but like what we are going to do next year. So although we use just a part of Airship 1.0, for the 2.0, we'll fully align with Airship project, not just like a partial involvement, I mean full technology stack. Since the 2.0 adopt concept of the Kubernetes cluster API, operator framework, and some of cloud native workflow engines, so they re-architectured their Airship and embraced all the Kubernetes technologies. And it will be fully declarative and fully Kubernetes API-driven architecture to deploy your entire infrastructure. So different from 1.0, it mainly integrates with existing open source software. So one goal of this integration is to keep Airship smaller and more focused in its mission, but leveraging or enhancing other best-in-class open source projects. So for example, Airship is looking into Metal Cube, Metal 3.io. I think Red Hat is mainly developing that open source. That's like the tools, operators, and cluster API to provision your bare metals using Ironic API. But it's all Kubernetes native technology. So the Airship 2.0 is embracing all this new technology and architecture and making 2.0. So the SKT also had plan to re-architecture our solutions, and the concept and technology set was like 99% similar between Airship 2.0 and our plan. So we decide to dive into this development of Airship 2.0 with community, and we'll develop 2.0 together, and we'll use the 2.0 into our system. So that's our plan. Also, that's Airship's plan to do. So next is the case study. It's case study on our NFV productions. And because of some of the existing operation limitation, we had to make a compromise. So what was compromise we did to meet these existing operations? And we'll, because sometimes introducing this kind of new architecture into our environment, production environment, very difficult because different from the web company, the SK Telecom has ops team and development team all separated, completely separated. So even though we come up with new architecture, a stable solution, some of operation tools, operation policy and process cannot support what you have. So we have to make compromise between our new technology and existing operation policy. So we'll describe what happened there. Also, the VNF has some unique requirements that need to be certified even with Kubernetes introduction into our system. So the John Han will explain some of that technical point.
As Jaesuk An mentioned already, so I will share our experiences struggling against most conservative organizations. The first requirement for adopting TACO, which is our solution into telco infrastructure, was performance. In TACO's and NFV environment, dedicated CPU setup is essential to ensure efficient use of NUMA, and non-VNF processes do not impact VNF performance. To meet this performance requirement, we use CPU pinning method. The main difference from CPU pinning in OpenStack-only environment is that Kubernetes system part, including OpenStack service containers, should not share CPUs with OpenStack VMs. Allocating specific CPUs to a VM can be done as follows. Edit graph file, which defines the value of ISO CPUs. We define all configurations of OpenStack service into an Armada manifest. The vCPUs pin set option has existed in Nova for defining which physical CPUs can be used by instance virtual CPUs. Possible value is a comma-separated list of physical CPU number that virtual CPUs can be allocated to by default. Each element should be either a single CPU number or range of CPU numbers. System containers managed by Kubernetes must be isolated to prevent the CPU used by OpenStack VMs. At first, create a directory under the C group only for Kubernetes system pod. After that, we define CPU numbers to be used for system pod into a CPU set.cpus file. The biggest requirement for infrastructure operators was to maintain service availability under any node failure. OpenStack service managed by Kubernetes can be automatically recovered even under reboot of all control nodes simultaneously. However, in some cases, you need to manually recover quickly. The first case is that two control nodes down and the subsequently come out again. The second case is all control nodes down and only one controller come up. We can complete manual recovery in a few steps under this situation. First, run etcd service with etcd first new cluster option, which means reset the number of etcd cluster to one node. And then remove failed control nodes from Kubernetes cluster. Set to one replica of all OpenStack pods in the Armada manifest file and redeploy OpenStack service. By doing this, we can restore the OpenStack control plane to the remaining node in the event of over half of the three control node failure. MariaDB chart of OpenStack Helm has a config map about cluster state in order to establish its own clustering. MariaDB can recover cluster status automatically utilizing this config map. The picture on the right side is a content of the config map. The prefix of sequence number means WSRP of an each MariaDB pod. The sequence number would be updated to their own WSRP number when the cluster of MariaDB is broken. The node that has the highest number of WSRP is selected or the leader of the cluster. After that, the value of safety bootstrap of the leader pod set to true. It is same as force recovery option to MariaDB Galera cluster. Slave node will join into the master node after master node is running successfully. It is very important that all MariaDB pods are time synced. If the difference in value of sample time between each node more than 20 seconds, the process of comparing the WSRP values and selecting the leader operation is not performed. We had to change several settings for establish stability of the service in the Armada manifest. The first was to change the pull polish of the container image from always to if not present. We set up private Docker registry for security reasons in telco infrastructure. If set the image pull polish to always, it will try to download images from the Docker registry whenever the container starts. If there is a problem with the Docker registry, the new containers cannot download from the registry and do not run properly. So change the pull polish to if not present so that it is not dependent on the state of the Docker registry. Pod affinity and pod entire affinity allow you to specify rules about how pods should be placed relative to other pod. It is better that set this option from preferred to required for use because the containers running on the failed node are migrated to other nodes in the failed control node and not come back even the node is recovered. This result in same containers running on a node. Operators familiar with looking logs of OpenStack service through files want to see the same logs for containers. There has been much debate about this requirement because this is very legacy way to see the log. But we accepted that their requirement. As an example of Nova services, as shown in the two pictures on the left, the logger handlers are divided by Nova services. And as shown in the picture of the right, the host directory can be mounted as a volume to see the log. By doing this, we can debug OpenStack services as same as legacy way. Infrastructure operators do not want changes in the control node to affect the data plane. For example, changing the configuration of Nova in the current structure of the Airship will restart not only the control service, but also the Nova compute service. To be precise, the existing Nova compute pod will be deleted and the new Nova compute pod will be started. To minimize the impact of these data planes, we have separated the chart of the controller and compute service. to divide the two charts, we need to define Nova compute chart independently, not included in Nova chart, and only enabled demo set compute part in the Nova compute chart. Next, Jaesok An, will explain about collaboration.
The things that John explained, especially log, we had a huge debate because why they're using just Elasticsearch in Kibana to look the log in the central place. And there are several reasons for the operators because, and one, there is not good like a tool set for the operator to do the centralized logging and the easy navigating. So we discussed with the ops team and we accepted we will provide legacy of looking into logging, but also they have to develop their operation tools to meet with this new way of the operating. So I think that was good, the value came out of this activity, productizing Kubernetes, OpenStack on Kubernetes into our production. Then with 5G and the vendors start suggest that they will deliver these containerized network functions. And ops team was delighted because they had experience with Kubernetes because of our implementation, and now they know some of the Kubernetes so that they can work with vendors. So I think like even though there is some of the compromise, you have to make your new architecture and new tools, working with operators closely and setting their also roadmaps together with our roadmap, that will be very important for us to slowly like apply this technology into like our tech environment. That was kind of lesson learned from us. And the collaborations. So to do that, as I told, we had to collaborate because in SKT we have like 9 people working in this project, just one team. It cannot be done. So we are so lucky to work with AT&T and other company on the Airship project and OpenStack Ham project, and that made us possible to make this production grade solution based on Kubernetes. So we value collaboration very much. Also, working on the Airship, we have to work with other ecosystem, Kubernetes and Prometheus, Grafana, and SAP. And to the setting up the process, internal process, on how the SKT or company, as a company, can collaborate with this open source community, not as just an individual developer, was very important for us to set up. That happened. And also, on that line, I explained briefly about ATS 3.0 and MBMP from MPEG. So MPEG also want to implement this MBMP spec with open source technology. So we are working with MPEG, trying to implement this MBMP platform into the OpenStack Foundation project. And that has been a little bit difficult because we have to talk with MPEG and OpenStack and other developers, but it's slowly proceeding. So we will create another collaboration on the media domain with this the Airship-based technologies. This is a 35-minute talk. I think we ended early. With that experience, I and our vision in SKT is that we really want to treat our infrastructure not as like a standing like a legacy one, but as just another cloud native app. So if you wanna deploy OpenStack or Kubernetes, you treat them as like a cloud native apps. You just put your manifest and deploy. So that's our vision. Because in 5G, we have to work with lots of different services requiring different infrastructure requirements. And we need to work with public cloud vendors. And also, we need to enhance our private cloud capability. And so we need capability to provision a different set of infrastructure on the different the environment, on bare metals, on the VMs, on the public cloud. So that makes us really, we need this way of dealing with infrastructure as a cloud native way. Otherwise, we will not meet all the requirements we will get in the near future. So that's last statement of my presentation. And if there is any question, I can get lots of that, I guess. Yes.
Yeah. Hi. So the question was that in the CPU pinning slide, you listed all the cores for the Nova config. So why is that?
I don't understand. Please. Yeah.
So why do you need to define this vCPU pin set parameter? So is this the set of CPUs which are used by the
VMs?
The VMs,
yeah,
okay.
So when they provision their VNF, they set all the predefined value in their template, and they also set which the CPU VNF VM has to work on. Mm-hmm. So we have to apply those predefined settings into OpenStack so that when you provision those VM, this has to be connected. It's a predefined CPU, so that's why we put those parameters into it.
Are those physical cores, though? I guess I don't understand that.
That's a physical core.
That is physical.
Yes. Okay. That's a VNF specific requirement. So it's not a general requirement that the specific VNF required to have this pinning to physical core.
Yeah, but that, okay. So, but then you introduce a dependency from the infrastructure because then your VNF assumes that you have at least 24 cores.
Yes.
Which is not.
That's true. So you have to have a right configure of your servers as well. So it's all predefined and very legacy way of provision your virtual network function into the system. Yes. Yeah. And we did not care about this CPU pinning for Kubernetes first time. We did not know the Kubernetes is not recognize this basic grub setting. So that's why we have to create the custom CPU set kube whitelist in C groups. To tell Kubernetes this is a CPU.
There is an open source project which makes this easier for you called CPU pooler.
CPU pooler, okay. Yeah. We'll look into that. Thank you. And any question? Okay, so this is a standard spec MPEG is developing. This is not my computer. So what they do is they want to have the set of standard the function registry. So if third-party vendor want to develop a media functions, the MPEG want to provide first, the standard way of workflow management tools. So tell those media function how to manage and define your workflow.
Transcoding, things like that?
Yeah.
Things like transcoding, things like that?
Yeah, transcoders and upscalers. If they want to put their media function into certain system, they have to head to cataloging of their apps functions, and they have to manage how to workflow, to manage workflow of provisioning those media function and making pipeline. And MPEG want to standardize these interfaces and this spec so that third-party vendor can create their functions, but using a standard way of the cataloging their functions and standard way of the managing their workflow so that you can learn technically on top any cloud. So okay. That's why what MPEG is trying to do.
So right now, vendors all do it their own way, basically. Yes. This is an abstraction.
And now MPEG sees like a 5G MEC, and they see the 5G has huge value to connecting with this media pipeline, so they can also can get leverage from those standards.
Thank you.
Yeah, no problem. Any question? Okay, then that will be all. Thank you.
Very good. For thank you.
Yes.
Thank you very much. Great presentation.
No problem.
This car?